2,500 years ago, Gautama Sakyamuni found a way of escape from the wheel of desire, suffering, and death. His teaching is known as the Dharma, the law, and he is called a Buddha, which means the awakened one. Delivers us from ignorance and delusion, but it does not forbid the use of the imagination. It holds that body and mind encompass each other, and that the disciplined use of the senses can lead towards enlightenment. This is the basis of Tantrism, which has been practiced in the great monasteries of Tibet until the present day. Tibetan Buddhism, forbidden in its homeland, has now come to the West. These ceremonies are presented by monks from the Gyuto Tantric College. Focuses on the shrine of the Buddha. Inside the shrine is a mandala, a plan of the world outside man and of the world within him. Contemplating this, the monks seek to realize the divine power of the Buddha that lies in the heart of every human being. Being chanted enters the heart and awakens the Buddha within. In this ancient style of chanting, preserved uniquely by the College of Gyuto, each monk sings more than one note at the same time. The ability to sing these chords is a result of the invocation and increases its power to awaken the mind. In the foothills of the Indian Himalayas, the present home of the Gyuto Tantric College. Established in Tibet in 1474, Gyuto is one of the main centers of tantric study in the Gelug, or the formed tradition of Tibetan Buddhism. Dalatulku, the 115th abbot of Gyuto. At its home in Lhasa, the capital of Tibet, Gyuto housed more than 900 monks, but only 100 were able to escape to India after the Chinese closed down all the monasteries in Tibet. Today the community has grown to 200 with the inclusion of novices between the ages of 7 and 14 who are being trained to succeed the older monks. The novice undergoes a thorough training. He must memorize and interpret the scriptures before he can be initiated into the practice of Tantra. Every monk works on a craft to help support the monastery. He's at his task 7 hours a day, 6 days a week, unless there are special religious ceremonies. Creation of mandalas is a special art of the Gyuto College. For some ceremonies, a mandala is made with colored sand. Afterwards, it is blown away in keeping with the transient nature of all existence. A tantric proverb says, "A man cannot venerate a god unless he is a god himself." He achieves this end in meditation by visualizing the image of a deity in all its details. The image complete in his mind, he enters it. Entering it, the distinction between himself and what he sees is abolished. This is divine union. Taken his vows, the duty of a monk is to think and act for the welfare of all beings. To this end, he says meditational prayers every day. In these daily prayers, the monk calls into himself the powers of the deity being invoked, which he may then use to help others on the way. He Occasion, traditional scarves are presented by the former abbot when blessing those monks who have accepted an invitation to perform their rites in the West. The leader of the group is their present abbot, Taratulku. Tulku says that if there is peace in the world, Buddhism will flourish, because Buddhism is based on reason and founded upon absolute truth. The teacher, Buddha, who has already discovered the truth, is showing us the way. Thus there can be no mistake as to our destination. First Tibetans were nomads in a land that is hard, cold, and largely infertile, where icy winds storm over treeless plateaus and isolated valleys on the rooftop of the world. Settled life was difficult, and material advance was slow. But in this mountainous land, the mind, faced by the monotony of life and the awe-inspiring forces of nature, turned freely inwards and there met the awesome powers of the other world. From this confrontation with the world of spirits, both good and bad, there evolved the ancient shamanistic faith of Tibet, known as Bön. Fierce and warlike in their beginnings, the Tibetans, by the 7th century, were exacting tribute from China and Nepal. At that time, the warrior king, Sonsten Gampo, was converted to Buddhism. He is revered by Tibetans as the first Dharma king, who set the people on the way of peace and compassion. The prayer wheel became a common sight throughout the land. One century later, the second Dharma king, Trisan Detsan, invited from India the Buddhist tantric master Padmasambhava. Padmasambhava is taken to be an emanation of the Lord Buddha and the personification of his tantric teachings. He transformed the shamanistic beliefs of the Tibetans into those of Buddhism. The wrathful deities of Tibetan Buddhism have their source in the demons and spirits of Bön, who thus became the guardians of the Dharma rather than its enemies. The outward similarity between the rites of Tantra and those of Bön allowed Tantrism to make swift progress. The Indian saint traveled the country, converting the people and exorcising demons. Padmasambhava introduced Lama dances in which exploits of sages, saints and warriors are enacted. After the time of the Dharma kings, political unity in Tibet disintegrated because of the hostility of the Burn priests. Following a period of intense persecution, Buddhism emerged triumphant. The monasteries became islands of peace and security and slowly undertook the functions of government. Sacred texts brought from India were translated by monks into Tibet's own script. Born in 1358 in eastern Tibet, Gyesan Kapa, the reformer, founded a new order of Buddhism whose followers became known as Gelupas, or virtuous ones. The monastery city of Kumbum was built 2 centuries later at his birthplace. Gyesan Kapa taught his followers never to lose sight of the highest ideal of Buddhism, to vow to endure the endless cycles of rebirth and existence until all beings had been brought to enlightenment. Gyesan Kapa's disciple was the first Dalai Lama. The Dalai Lama is revered as the living and active presence of Chenrezig, Lord of Compassion and patron deity of Tibet. The Tibetans recognize many incarnations, such as this boy. He is a tulku, an enlightened being, who has chosen to be reborn to help humanity. Jekunga Tondup, an incarnation of Gyesan Kapa and a disciple of the first Dalai Lama, founded Gyuto Tantric College in 1474. Gelupas attracted a large following throughout Tibet and under the succession of Dalai Lamas laid the basis for a fusion of temporal and spiritual leadership. The Potala Palace in Lhasa was built at the end of the 17th century by the 5th Dalai Lama. The 5th Dalai Lama is revered for having united the country under the rule of Buddhism. Dominated by the Potala, Lhasa became the center of government, in which laymen and monks of all sects participated. A Christian mission under the Jesuit father, Desideri, was welcomed in Lhasa in 1716. But made little headway after failing to convince the lamas in public debate. The line of Dalai Lamas continued to rule a unified Tibet throughout the 18th and 19th centuries. Meanwhile, the growing power of China forced Tibet to close her borders to foreigners. Tibet remained a hidden land until the turn of the 20th century, when explorers and diplomatic missions arrived from Europe. In 1904, the 13th Dalai Lama was faced with a British invasion under the command of Colonel Francis Younghusband. The Tibetans played off this new force against the power of the Chinese. The political conflict between the Tibetans, the Chinese, and the British was resolved at the Simla Convention in 1914, when Britain guaranteed Tibet's independence. Before he died in 1933, however, the 13th Dalai Lama heard that Chinese communists had destroyed a Buddhist monastery in Mongolia. He prophesied that before long the same would come to pass in Tibet. He foretold that soon there would be no Dalai Lama, that religion and memory of the past would be rooted out, and that the people would have their land taken from them. He warned Tibetans that they should prepare themselves spiritually for days and nights that would be spent in fear. In October 1950, Chinese communist armies attacked eastern Tibet and in the following year occupied Lhasa. The Tibetans were forced to recognize the leadership of the communist government, while the Chinese agreed not to interfere with the status and function of the Dalai Lama or with the practice of Buddhism. The people proved stubbornly loyal to both. It became clear that the communists had no intention of keeping their word. This film, taken in 1958, shows the present Dalai Lama leaving his summer palace to visit the great monasteries of Ganden, Sera, and Trepung near Lhasa. Dalai Lama arrives at the monastery of Ganden, founded in the 15th century by Jesson Kapa. It is the home of more than 5,000 monks. He is to be examined on his 13 years of religious studies. The monks receive gifts in celebration of the day's event. The Dalai Lama debates questions of theology and metaphysics with high lamas, with his tutors on either side. It is by no means certain that he will pass. First, he answers questions put to him by his examiners. Now it is his turn to question them. The successful completion of the first examination is marked by a festival of dancing. The Jokhang, main temple in Lhasa, is the scene of his final examination before an assembly of 20,000 monks. It took place during Tibet's New Year celebrations. Exactly 1 year later, the Chinese, faced with armed resistance throughout Tibet, attempted to remove the Dalai Lama as being the symbol of the country's fight for freedom. As the people of Lhasa rose in his defense, the Dalai Lama allowed himself to be led to India and to exile, to be followed by tens of thousands of Tibetans as the rebellion was put down and all forms of religious life outlawed. Gyuto monks arrive in the West 14 years later. London, July of this ceremony is the consecration of temples and sacred images. the Buddhas are called upon to come and to remain with the celebrants who dedicate themselves again to the welfare of all beings. They present offerings of sandalwood that is mixed with water into a paste in token of their desire to purify the acts of their bodies, the intentions of their speech, and the awareness of their minds. I wash the body of the Buddha to cleanse the body of all sentient beings. I wash the speech of the Buddha to cleanse the speech of all sentient beings. I wash the mind of the Buddha to cleanse the mind of all sentient beings. Manifestations, both peaceful and wrathful. In the peaceful form of Manjushri, he embodies divine wisdom. The same manifestation in its wrathful aspect is Yamataka. In this ceremony, Yamataka is invoked as the king of the law, punisher of the wicked, rewarder of the virtuous, and conqueror of Yama, king of death. Receives a silver chalice filled with a mixture of butter and honey, symbolic of the golden eye ointment. Just as an excellent eye doctor may remove the film covering the eye, so may your ignorance be removed by the Buddhas. The abbot takes the mirror. All dharmas are like reflected images, clear and pure, without turbulence, ungraspable, inexpressible, truly arisen from cause and from action.
Lord, 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 Lord.
right hands, the monks hold the doggery. Shaped like a double thunderbolt, it signifies a mental power as clear, cutting, and indestructible as a diamond. This is known as the skillful means by which enlightenment is won, and as the universal compassion that comes with enlightenment. In their left hand is the tilbu, or bell. It rings because it is hollow, and being as it were empty of selfhood, it stands for the unobstructed wisdom of pure mind. In its sound, the method and practice of Tantra speak with one voice. Yamataka, the wheel of Dharma will turn always for the good of all sentient beings. Of universal compassion. As the protector of all beings, he appears in wrathful form as Mahakala, Black Lord of transcending awareness. In the fearful charnel ground of sandalwood groves, amidst the wisdom fire, treading the opponents of the Dharma, six-armed wonderful Mahakala, his great and powerful voice fills the universe with the sound of the Dharma.
Thank you.
from the natural clearness, essentially unchanged from the peaceful and compassionate, but now in wrathful appearance, dispel the enemies of the Dharma, within and without. Great Mahakala, approach. Great Dark Mahakala, approach. Dark Mahakala of great goodness, approach. Great guardian of the Dharma, approach.
Thank you.
all the Buddhas we have invoked enter our hearts to remain with us and with all sentient beings forever.